Hi, my name is Tina, and this is Knitting Blooms. You can find show notes for everything I talk about on my blog at www.knittingblooms.com. And if I miss a link, please feel free to contact me on Ravelry as Bloomingknitter. Or you can email me at knittingblooms@gmail.com. Come and join the Ravelry group so you can be eligible for all the prize drawings. And be sure to introduce yourself so that I can get to know you also. You can also follow me on Instagram and Twitter as Bloomingknitter. And don't forget to click the like button on Facebook for Knitting Blooms. Lolo Baby, available in soft vanilla, lavender dreams, and plain and simple, has been a big hit among OBGYN staff, new moms, daycare personnel, and men over 60. A swipe on the diaper area, a bit for a massage, or something to help with cradle cap, we understand. But why are men buying this? So we asked. We just had to know. And they told us. They are buying Lolo Baby and using it for itch, heat, and chafing in their southern hemisphere. We pressed on with our somewhat awkward questions, and we found out that while they loved Lolo Baby, they wanted two things to be different: the label and a cooling element. So along came Southern Comfort. Don't let the mustache on the label lead you to think it's only for men. Women are buying it as well. And yes, we had to ask. And we were told they were using it for all the same reasons, though they used different words like friction and rash. Southern Comfort is ideal for those that bike, pedal, or motor, those that wear skirts with no pantyhose, and those that could just use some comfort in their southern hemisphere. Southern Comfort is for external use only. To buy, visit www.bar-maids.com. Hi, thanks so much for joining me today. I'm so glad that you've decided to spend your time with me. I am glad to be spending time with you, although, oh no, Cody's gonna start already. Come on up here. Come on. I barely got through the introduction and he starts again. I don't know what it is with him when I get set up to do the podcast. He needs special attention. Anyway, I am happy to be sitting and chatting with you guys today, although I'm kind of a little out of sorts today. I'm not really sure why. It might be, I think I'm getting a sinus infection. The whole left side of my face here is just really sensitive. I don't feel stuffed up, I don't have a headache or anything like that, but this morning I woke up and just touching my face, it just hurts. So I'm wondering if I'm getting a sinus infection. So that's kind of been a down part of today. The other thing that could be the reason that I'm out of sorts is because I've been playing a lot of Sims. So I've been living my Sims life instead of living my real life. I'm not sure if that's it or not. But actually, this week, I installed a new mod on my game. Now, I've always played Sims, the base game, you know, with my expansion packs and all of that. But I've never installed third-party mods or custom content. Now, I used to do that. I used to install third-party custom content and mods. However, this was when I played Sims 2, and I don't know if it was that my computer, I just tried to overload my computer or what exactly, but the mods never worked properly, and then things got corrupted, so I completely stopped adding third-party custom content and third-party mods. However, this time I added the third-party mod because it gives me an option to reset the entire town. Because one of the reasons when I play Sims that over time I end up
not playing for a long period of time is because what happens is I play a family, and after 4 or 5 or 7 weeks or whatever playing the same family, things start to lag. I don't know why, but it does, and it always has. I can't remember if it did with Sims 2 or not, but Sims 3 has always been like that. And so I get frustrated after playing a few Sim weeks, which is like almost 3 months. It's like, I think they consider like a week as like a quarter. Anyway, so I would get frustrated, and then I would quit playing for a while until a new expansion pack came out, or I learned about a new challenge, or something like that. So this time I was playing, and I decided, okay, yesterday or the day before, I just said, let's see if there's anything about this, if I did a search on the internet for the game lagging. And I found some notes and stuff about this mod, and I'm like, okay, let's try it. Let's see how it works. And so far, it's been awesome. It used to be that I could only play for an hour at a time to prevent the game from getting, you know, too over, overtaxed. And I'd have to turn it off and shut down my computer and kind of refresh everything. And then I can turn it back on again. Well, the last 2 days, I have played for 4, 5, 6 hours straight through, not stopping. Which is a huge waste of time, but it's such a fun game. And actually, I'm doing this one game now where I am first trying to learn how to ride a horse, which I haven't gotten that far yet, and also I've been on a lot of vacations where I'm doing some exploring of some tombs and stuff like that, so that's kind of fun. But I'm trying not to be so much of a micromanager, because that's what I usually do, is I micromanage my Sims and make them do certain things, and I'm trying not to do that this time, but there are certain goals that I want to accomplish. So, needless to say, out of sorts a little bit, but we're going to go with it. I do have show notes here, but they're very sparse. I have no idea what I'm going to talk about. We're just going to wing it. Let's see. The blip links. If you never transferred over the link from blip, when I did all that changing last year, you are going to need to do that, because blip is no longer going to be submitting the podcast feed to iTunes. Which means that you may stop receiving podcasts and there will be no updates. Now, this might have already happened, but if you find that you are not receiving your updates from iTunes, check your feed. You should be able to unsubscribe to or delete the Knitting Blooms podcast from your Downcast app or whatever app you use. And then research for Knitting Blooms, and it will pick up the correct iTunes link. So if you haven't done that yet, you need to do that. Otherwise, you're not going to get any more podcasts on your app. So that's one thing that we need to talk about. The next thing is there is still one spot left for the second weekend of Knittopia, which is... let me just pull up my calendar. I think it's the 20th through the 23rd, or the 19th through the 23rd. Let me find my calendar on here. I don't usually look at my calendar on here. So we're looking at, so it's the 20th through the 23rd. That's Thursday, March 20th through Sunday, March 23rd. And the cost is $140. This is the last call. If I don't get somebody who wants to come to the retreat for that weekend in the next week or so, I have another person who is coming the first weekend who has said that she wouldn't mind coming the second weekend if nobody else wants that spot. So as of maybe the 14th or so of February, probably let's go with the 16th, so it's the whole weekend, I'm going to give her the spot. But she said, go ahead and let's see if somebody else wants it, and then we'll go from there. So that's the 20th through the 23rd of March. And it's $140. Now, we still have midweek spots available as well. That would be from the 16th through the 20th. So if you want to come for the 16th through the 20th and then stay through the 23rd, that's available right now. So, yes, I know. Yeah, you're fine right there. So if you are interested, get in contact with me quick, because like I said, if I don't hear from somebody saying that they are ready to commit and send their payment for the spot by the 16th of February, then I'm going to go ahead and release it to that other person who said that they were interested in taking the spot. Are you going to come up here and talk to me? Okay. So that's the second thing on the list. The next thing on the list is the Knit Companion. Now, you all know that I love the Knit Companion, and they are currently doing a Kickstart program because they are trying to get a software that will go onto the Androids as well. Right now, they have only on the iDevices, and I have my Knit Companion on all of my iDevices, and I love it, and technically, it doesn't matter to me whether it goes to Android or not because I don't have any Android devices. However, they do state that even if you are an iDevice person, this transition will help you in the long run because they're doing something with the design of the software for more of a broader spectrum. So if you are interested in helping out to raise money to bring Knit Companion to Android, then head on over to the Kickstart website. I believe there's only going through like the 17th or 18th of February. So you need to hurry over and make your donation if you want to do that. I have already made my donation. And I think it's a great cause to try and help them out. I will put a link in the show notes as well for that. The next thing I want to talk to you about, last week I talked about my steps for 2014. And after thinking about it a little bit more, I said last week that I wanted to increase my steps by 25,000 steps for 2014. And having done over 6 million steps in 2013, 25,000 was not really a reasonable goal. I mean, it was like, oh, that's like a drop in the bucket. So I reevaluated. And instead of 25,000, I think it's going to be 3%, and I think it comes out to almost, it's either almost 300,000 or almost 400,000. I can't remember if it's like 288,000 or 388,000 additional steps, which means that I need to average around 123 steps a week. That's about 17,500 steps a day. And that's still a lot of steps because most people, when they are trying to get steps, their goal is around 10,000. So 17,500 steps is a lot, and that's my goal for my daily goal. There are going to be days that I do well over 17,500. In fact, I think one day this week I did 25,000. But there are also going to be days that I do under 17,000. Like today, I don't think I'm going to hit 17,000 today. I think I'm at around 10,000 now, and I'll probably do a little bit more stepping tonight, but I'll be lucky if I do another 3,000 tonight. So Yeah. So I did alter those goals because I just after thinking about it, after talking about it last time on the podcast, I just thought, you know what, that's nothing. I could beat that in 1 week. So I decided to go ahead and increase that. And what this means is that the first few weeks of the month of the year, almost all of January, I wasn't really doing that. So I have to make up quite a bit because I was not doing 17,500 on average for the first month of the year. And I believe that I have about 50,000 steps to make up for stuff that I missed in January. That doesn't account for anything that in the future, if I were to get a short day, this is only to make up for the January days that did not have 17,500 on average. So I have quite a bit of makeup to do. My plan was to do an extra 10,000 steps a day. Is it 10,000 a day? I think it's 10,000 a week that I need to do for the next like 4 weeks or 5 weeks in order to make up that time. Now, I don't have to do those 50,000 steps in the next 5 weeks, but the sooner I can get it done and out of the way, the sooner I can start building up a buffer for those days when I don't hit 17,500 steps. So, lofty goals for steps in 2014. what else? Oh, I think I have finally come up with something that I would like to do for those people that have made donations to the podcast. Now, I have all of my videos online, all of my tutorials online. However, you have to be connected to the internet to watch them, or you need to download them and make them available on your computer. I want to make that easier for you. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to start making DVDs of my videos. Now, a DVD can be for up to 120 minutes. And what I'm going to do is I think I'm going to set up an item on Etsy, because I have an Etsy account. I think I'm going to set up an item on Etsy so that you would go in and you would say, I want to have this tutorial, and this episode. Up to 120 minutes. And then I will record a DVD that you can play on your DVD player, on your computer, or on your TV, or whatever, that you'll have it. You don't need to be connected to the internet. You will have it always. And then you can have it, without having to go online. Now, like I said, you still have access online. Those videos will always be out there, and they are for free. But this is a way for you to help support the podcast. The price is going to be $7.50 for each DVD. And like I said, you would be able to designate which episodes, which tutorials you want on the DVD. And I would create the DVD for you, and I'm going to have a nice little case and labels and what have you. And then I will ship it off to you. And this is for basically making a donation to the podcast. So what I'm going to do in the next couple of weeks is I'm going to get in contact with everybody who's made a donation to the podcast in the past 2.5 years. And I'm going to ask them what they want. If they want one. Maybe they don't want one. And you can still make a donation to the podcast without getting a DVD. But this is just a way for me to be able to give you something tangible for making your donation. Instead of just saying, here's $5, here's $10, whatever. So everybody who's made a donation that has been over $7.50 in the last 2 years, you will be getting an email from me on your PayPal email in the next few weeks. Hopefully in the next few weeks. I have Knitopia in about a month, so I'm going to do my absolute best to make sure I get in touch with everybody and see if they are interested in having a DVD. Now, those people that made donations in the last 2 years, if they made a donation over $750, there will be no charge for their first DVD. So I will get in contact with them and ask them what they want, and they will be the first people to get DVDs. If somebody doesn't want a DVD, then I'll be moving on to anybody new. But like I said, I'm going to set up an Etsy shop and put like kind of like pre-orders where you would go in and you'd select the item, and then in the comments you would put which episodes or tutorials that you want. I hope that makes sense. If you have questions about how it's going to work, let me know. You know, I'm always available on Ravelry, or you can email me, what have you. So, just let me know. Okay, so I do have some knitting progress, but don't really have a whole lot of explanation or revelations or anything like that happened with the knitting in the last couple weeks. So most of the stuff I'm going to show you, I'm going to kind of fly through quickly. Just show you my progress, so to speak. Because really there's not much new with it. I will start with this project. This is my little big shrug. No chewing on the yarn. Hey! This is my little big shrug, and it is coming along. You see my... Cody, I'm going to make you get down. Come on. I'm sorry. You playing with the yarn. You see where my marker is, and I have done I've done 3 repeats. The repeats are 16 rows. Yeah, 16 rows. So, yeah, it's coming along. You know, I work on this whenever I, am sitting down, because I can't really work on this, bouncing on the ball or anything like that. Nothing too exciting about the pattern or anything like that. I am alternating skeins. That's going well. I think I have like, I don't know how many inches, a lot of inches to go, because it's a shrug. It's going to go cuff to cuff. I have a long way to go on this one, but it's coming along. I am making progress. That is the important thing. The next project are my featherweight socks. And what I had done on these, here are both of them. I am past the heel on both of them. As I mentioned last week, one of them, this one, is a little bit more pink than this one. But that's because I'm using two different balls. But I think it's possible that I might have enough yarn to make 2 full pairs. So maybe I'll be able to get socks that are a little bit close if I make 4 socks. But we'll see. If not, it's not a big deal. Anyway, what I did on these socks, I did my regular normal heel. However, before I started doing my heel, my short rows, I increased 4 stitches on the heel. And then when I was done doing my heel, my heel turn and everything, I decreased those stitches back down. I have tried this sock on, and I think the heel is too deep. I'm not going to undo it and redo it. I'm going to leave it as is. However, next time I do this, and I think one of the reasons is because I think I made the foot a little bit too long, because I made the foot my normal length, and then I added a little bit extra on the heel. So I think if I had shortened the foot a little bit to account for the extra stitches in the heel, it might have been better. And one of the reasons why I did add the extra stitches for the heel is because I find that sometimes on the top of my foot, the fabric stretches a little bit more because of it goes over my my instep. And I was trying to prevent that. But now the heel is a little bit too roomy. But I think it'll be fine. They're socks for me, so it's just going to be a little bit roomy of a heel. I might try something a little bit different next time, and we'll see how that goes. And I am still using my Addi Turbo sock rockets, and I love them. Love them. I will be definitely purchasing more Addi Turbo sock rockets. They are probably going to be my new favorite sock needles. The next project is my Knit Swirl, and again, not too much excitement going with this, other than the fact that I have cast off and I am working on the back. Here is my marker, right here. So I've done quite a bit since the last time I showed you. Oh, and guess what? Remember I did an interview a few months ago with Ariana Quilt Moxie, and I have to tell you, this orange marker is something else. Anyway, I have to tell you, her and I have the same camera, and remember every other week for the longest time, I've had trouble showing you my project because I didn't know which way to go. Well, there is a mirror image setting on the camera that Ariana happened to find one day. And she pointed it out to me. And actually, there's another setting that I found the other day when I was looking for the mirror image thing. And it was a voice difference. So I changed that up when I was recording the tutorial last weekend. And I wanted to change it again today, but I could not find the setting. So I hope the voice is okay, because I think I changed it to like a speech type of thing, but I wanted to change it to like in crowd, so that the background noise, I was hoping that if I changed it to like in a crowd, you wouldn't pick up all the background noise from Steve walking around upstairs, from the furnace going off, all that. Anyway, I'll figure out what that is later, but I'm so happy that Ariana told me about the mirror image thing. Anyway, so the pink marker down here is where I was the last time I showed you. This marker up here is to tell me where my decreases stop, so I can count how many welts I have, and I like to check my stitches and whatnot. So it's coming along. I haven't actually worked on this since club last weekend. I put it down. I put it down, and I'll tell you why I put it down in a few minutes when I talk about my spinning. But I put it down after club and just haven't really picked it back up again. Haven't really done a whole lot of knitting since club last weekend. Okay. The next project are the socks for my father-in-law, and they are making progress as well. These are the two-tone socks that I am making him, with the blue and the kind of oatmeal color. I am still not sure if I like this two-tone look, but really this is the only option I have to make sure I have enough yarn for the socks. I'm hoping that I have enough yarn. We'll see what happens. So yeah, they're coming along. It's a huge sock. I think he has a 13-inch foot or something like that. Something large. And so I'm just knitting on them when I get a chance. Usually when I'm bouncing on my ball at home. I haven't been taking these out. And I did the same thing with this heel as I did with the other, the featherweight heel, socks heel. I increased 2 extra stitches before doing my short rows, and then decreased them back out again in hopes that it would make that heel a little bit deeper for his foot. Yeah, and I think this stitch marker here is where I was the last time. So I've done quite a bit since the last time. And plain stockinette on navy and a huge sock, which really, I think it's only 64 stitches or 68 stitches, because it's kind of like a heavy worsted sport weight. So, but it's coming along. I haven't started the second one because I want to see how much the sock weighs and what have you, and how much weight is left in the ball when I finish the first one, and hopes that I will have enough for the second one. And my last project, I had hoped to be a little bit further along on. In fact, hang tight for 1 second. I have something else to get. Okay. So yeah, I had hoped that I would be a little further along on this project. However, I started it and then I restarted it. So this piece is the piece that I started first. Okay, I got, you know, a decent bit going on it. But I was using size 6 seed beads. Now, I'm thinking when I'm looking at the pattern and the yarn is supposed to be lace weight, I'm thinking size 8 seed beads. That sounds about right. I didn't read the pattern. I didn't see what the notes said. And so that's what I bought, size 8. Now, I already had two containers of this and I just ordered more. I probably didn't need to order any more. It probably would have been fine with two, but I just wanted to be sure that I had enough. Anyway, I didn't like how this was coming out. These size 8 seed beads, they're just really getting lost in the knitting. Let's see if there we go. You can kind of see that there. And there's another one over there. But I just felt like those beads were just a little bit too small. The other one's over here. So I stopped. And I ordered some size 6 in the same colorway. And I'm restarting it. This is actually a shawl for my mom. She saw I had made this shawl a few years ago. It was a mystery shawl. And I had made it a few years ago and she saw it and she really liked it. And she asked me if I would knit it for her. So I am. So I've restarted this. But because I had to order the beads, which were ordered last Sunday, because I was working on this on Saturday at club, and that's when I was like, I did a few rows. I did three rows of the beads, and I even asked the girls at club, and at first I thought it was going to be okay, this first one, but then when I got down a little bit further, this one right here, for instance, I don't know if it'll come up, if it'll focus enough. This one right here, it really is getting buried under like a double decrease kind of thing. And I just didn't like how that was looking. I mean, this shawl is pretty beaded, pretty well beaded. I think there's over 800 beads on it. So the few that are going to be kind of covered up by a double decrease, it's probably not that big of a deal. But I just thought, you know what? I think I'm gonna like it better if it had the size 6 beads on it. So, done. I said, forget it. I started again. And I've stopped here because now I'm waiting for my beads. I order from the Bead Wrangler, and they are usually pretty quick with their orders. So my guess is that they may have even come in today's mail. Today's mail was not here when I sat down. Or tomorrow. So I should be able to make some good progress on it this weekend if I can tear myself away from Sims. It's so sad. It really is. But man, I want to learn how to ride a horse. I have never explored that part of the pets thing. So I think it would be so much fun. Anyway, so I've made some progress on it. But I'm waiting. The next row is for beads and I have to wait till the beads get here. But like I said, they should be here today or tomorrow. I'm not worried. I know that they are always very quick with their shipping. And that's my knitting this week. And now for my spinning and the reason why I put down my knit swirl. I finished spinning my fiber nymph from my 2013 Knitopia colorway, and I wanted to start plying it. So the girls were here for club on Saturday. I think I finished spinning the last bit Friday night. It was either Friday night or early Saturday morning before the girls got here, and I was anxious to start plying it. And what I did was I took all the bobbins, now all except for the last bobbin, because I needed to wind that off onto a bobbins up bobbin, but I lined them all up. And at first, when I was doing this in my head, I was thinking that I was going to mix and match them and, you know, what have you. But what I did was I knew that I was going to make three skeins of four bobbins. I had 12 bobbins. So I just started lining them up. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12. And that's how I decided to spin them. So I have a picture to show you because I took a picture of all of them lined up. And so what I did was it was like 3, 4, 7, and 10 is what I used for the first bobbin. And then 2, Cody, please stop chewing on that. You're going to electrocute yourself. He's chewing on the extension cord. Come over here. Then the next one was 2, 5, 8, and 11, so forth. So, I'm hoping that it was enough of a variance that it worked. And then what I did was I put those on the wheel. Now, I put them on my ladybug because my lazy cake only holds three bobbins, so I had to have something that held four bobbins, so I have it on my wheel, on my ladybug. And what I did was I put 1, 4, 7, and 10 so that they're all in order. So that when one of the bobbins ran out, I think 4 was the first one to run out. So then I put 5 in that spot. So I replaced the bobbin with the next one for the next skein. Does that make sense? And then when the last bobbin of the first set was done, that's when I cut off my first skein. And I finished my first skein. And here it is. And I love it! Let me get you a close-up view of it. And it is awesome. It seems to be maybe a little overspun, which is not surprising. And the only reason is that I think so is because, you know, like you see right in here, you get a little bit of a wiggleness right there. But I love it. And I have finished spinning the second bobbin. This is the second bobbin that I just need to wind off onto the woolly winder. Let's focus here. That I need to wind off onto the woolly winder. And then I will soak it. I have already soaked this one. And I'm thinking it is a light worsted or DK, which is exactly what I was going for. I was nervous that if I went with a 3-ply instead of a 4-ply, it would be a fingering weight, and I wasn't really sure that I wanted a fingering weight. I wanted a light worsted or a DK weight, sport weight. I have not done any sort of measurements or anything like that, any wraps per inch or anything. I want to finish spinning it all, and then finish soaking it, and then I'm going to divide everything up, because when I do my sweater, I'm going to need to alternate skeins. And since I only have three skeins, I'm going to need to break each one of these 8-ounce skeins, or approximately 8 ounces. I think this one came out to about 7.5. I'm going to need to break each one of the skeins into half, and then match them up again to be able to alternate. So, and then I'm going to knit a swatch because I have no clue what kind of fabric I'm going to get. I'm going to knit a swatch and see what I like, and figure out how much yardage I have, and then I'm going to choose my pattern. It's going to be a long process, but it's going to be so much fun. But I definitely want to get this started before Knitopia. And that's like 5 weeks away. It's crazy. So this is what I've been doing before I started playing Sims. I was spinning this. I spun this one up on Saturday evening, finished it up on Sunday, and started the second one on Sunday, and then finished that one up Sunday night and started the third one. And really, I haven't done too much since then. Yeah, I just need to get back to it. It's started. I've got... I think I've put the first bobbin of the third skein on, and the other ones are just winding out. And then as soon as I run out of that one and I only have three bobbins left, I might have to do some finagling and moving of some singles to balance it out and be able to continue and still make a four ply. So yeah, that's a lot of spinning that I need to do, and I'm so excited that I am nearly done with that fiber. I was going to do a book review for you today, but I have decided to hold off until next time to do the book review, because I started to look at the book over the weekend, and then I decided that I would like to start a project from the book before I do the book review. So I'm hoping that this weekend I will motivate myself to start a project from the book that I will do next week or next time I record. And then I will be able to show you my progress on my project and do the book review. However, we do have some drawings, one for Geometrix and also the iTunes comment drawing. Okay, so Geometrix drawing. We had lots of people enter, and it is a great book. Like I mentioned last time when I recorded and I did the book review, I really want to make some of those mittens. I really should make them now, but I just have so much on the needles right now and so many other projects that I want to work on before Knitopia, and I just don't know if I'm going to get another pair of mittens started this year. But I will definitely be making a pair of mittens, worsted weight mittens from that book, definitely by next year. Maybe this summer. We'll see how that goes. But yeah. So we have one winner for the ebook, and that goes to number 52, and that's Freeman 5. So congratulations, you are the winner of that ebook. Just get in contact with me, and then I will forward your Ravelry ID over to Maria, who is the designer of the book, and she will gift you the ebook. So congratulations, that is going to be so much fun for you to be able to knit. Now we have an iTunes drawing, and here are the new ones that are going right in there. I almost decided to either skip the drawing for this week or skip adding the people this week, but then I thought it's not going to take that much time to look them up and print them. I only look up the US and Canada, so if you have put in a review for another country other than the US or Canada, let me know, because I will not go to those countries unless I know for sure that there's a comment. But if you have put in a comment from the US or Canada, then your name is in this. And these include the ones that have just come in the last week. There was two in the last week and then a couple in January. So this is the January drawing, and it's for a pattern of $7 or less on Ravelry. And you have to contact me, because many times I don't know what, because the name that is used on iTunes is not always your Ravelry ID. So you must contact me. So let's pull a winner here without Cody eating my fingers off. So here we go. Let's see. Is this one? This is one. And it goes to Venus1962. So if that is you and you've posted a comment on iTunes with that username on iTunes, then you have won this month's pattern. So get in contact with me, and I will send it to you. Just let me know what you want, and I will send that right out to you. So those are the drawings. I don't think that we have any more drawings. Oh, we did have spinuary. Okay, so we're gonna wait and do that one next time. So if you're still spinning, keep adding your finished items into the thread. If you have spun stuff in February, I'm gonna extend it for another 2 weeks. So spin, spin, spin. And I did have that on this list, but I didn't look at my show notes before I sat down. And also we have the colorwork mitten knit along. See, I told you. I was thinking, oh, we have two drawings. There's clearly four drawings listed here. So both for spinuary and the colorwork mittens, keep going on them. If you've still working on your colorwork mittens, keep going. And if you finish them before I record next time, which will be, I think, the 19th of February, then post them and you are still entered to win. And same with spinuary. Still go, go, go on that spinning. 4 ounces or more must be plied or finished. If you're not going to ply the yarn, then please note that in the thread, in the finished object thread. Can't believe I did that. Anyway, it is what it is, and I don't feel like going and trying to do more prizes. So we're going to draw those next time. And it gives you more time to enter. I want to tell you that we are going to have another VKN soon. It's going to be on February 21st, which is a Friday again. And I know Friday's not always good for everybody, but we were doing Saturdays for a long time, and I just wanted to try a different day. So it's going to be the 21st of February. It's Friday, and we will be meeting at 8 p.m. Eastern Standard Time on Google. And I will post the link to the chat room a little bit before 8. So if you are available to sit down and chat with us on the 21st, that would be so much fun. So the next time after the February date will not be until probably April, because I will be at Knitopia in March for 12 days. And there just won't be enough time to do it. So the next one will be in April after that. So I hope you can join us in February. Now, I am going to be starting a new knit along. And it's going to be kind of a 2014 knit along. And the reason I want to do it is because my goal for 2014 is to knit primarily from my stash. So this is not to say that there won't be new stash coming in, but this is to say that I want to knit primarily from what is already in my stash. So here are the rules. For the months of February and March, because March is going to be crazy busy for me with Knitopia, I don't want to get too crazy with it. So for February and March, because we're only a week into February, but you might need a month and a half to do this. For February and March, make sure that all of your stash is listed in Ravelry. Now, maybe you can't list all of your stash in Ravelry, but maybe you can go through your stash and decide what projects you're going to knit in 2014 and list those yarns in Ravelry, because to be eligible to enter to win prizes in this knit along, your stash must be in Ravelry. And it must have a posted date in Ravelry, or a created date in Ravelry, prior to March 31st, 2014. Which means that you acquired the yarn prior to March 31st and then entered it into Ravelry before March 31st. Because I can check that. So between now and the end of March, go through your stash, figure out what you think you're going to knit this year, and post that stash in Ravelry. And then, starting in April, start knitting from your stash. Now, you can start knitting from it now, but you just have to make sure that that stash is already in Ravelry. For every finished object, you can post to the finished object thread, and it will be an entry to win a prize. And I will be doing monthly drawings. This will last from April to the end of the year. It'll be like our year-long knit-along. And, well, it's not really going to be a year-long. It's going to be April to December, but still. And every month I will do a drawing, kind of like what we've been doing for the iTunes, where I just go through and pull a name. So we'll have a finished object and a chatter thread. I might be pulling from both as far as prizes. There'll be, I think that's it. So monthly drawings, finished objects, chatter thread, must be in your stash on Ravelry before March 31st to be entered to win. Because if I pick your name, I'm going to check to make sure that that stash was listed before March 31st. Because if it was listed after March 31st, then it means that you could potentially have purchased it after March 31st. And the idea is to knit from your current stash. I'm not saying you can't buy more stuff, just that the stuff that's going to be entered in this drawing is for current stash prior to March 31st. I know that Tammy, the proverbial knitter, is doing something similar to this. She's trying to work down her stash as well. So you might want to check out her podcast and see how you can double dip. Yeah. So I think it's going to be a lot of fun. I know I'm going to try and work for my stash as much as possible and try and work that down. I know that I've said that before, but we're going to really do it this year. And this is going to be the Knit Your Stash year-long challenge. And I think that's all I've got for you this week. I actually thought this was going to be a fairly short show because I didn't really have much notes. But it actually went longer than I expected. Anyway, I hope everybody has a great couple of weeks until I record again. I will be posting the second part of the beginner tutorial next week. That will be for the continental knitting. And then I'm not sure what's going to come after that. I'm going to try and record several tutorials that I can post and have uploaded while I'm at Knitopia. However, I might not do that. I don't know yet. And if I do post while I'm at Knitopia, it probably will be on the blog only that goes to iTunes. I won't be posting everywhere. I won't be posting to YouTube. I won't be posting to Blip. I won't be posting to all the different other blogs. It'll be to Knitting Bloom's blog only. Because what I can do is I can post it, I can upload it, and then set it to release on a certain day on the blog. But everything else would have to be done that day. So I will post to the, if I do that, I will post to the blog, and then when I get back, I will update all the other avenues that I post to, because I do post to a lot of different places. I post to the Knitting Blooms blog, which is the main blog. Then I post to the Bloomingknitter blog, which is my original blog that I was blogging when I was just talking about my knitting before I started podcasting. And then I have my Knitting Blooms blogger blog. Knitting Blooms blogger blog. which I had started before I went to WordPress, and then there's Blip and iTunes and whatnot, so a lot of places to go. And then all the updates as far as Google Plus and Plurk and Ravelry and you name it, it's crazy. It takes me a while to post to all those places. So, but my goal, my plan is to have some pre-recorded episodes or pre-recorded tutorials that I can post and upload and then, you know, schedule them to be released while I am at Knitopia. That's the plan. Not sure if it's going to go through or not, but that's the plan. So that's all I've got. And like I said, I hope you have a good couple of weeks. I'm going to be busy with Knitopia stuff. I'm going to try and pull myself away from Sims so that I can do some knitting. And yeah, I'll see you in a couple weeks. Bye for now.
Have you seen the new Twisted Lights from Barmaids? Twisted Lights are the most incredible beeswax candle with a very long burn time. For example, the smaller of the Twisted Lights burns for approximately 20 hours. But that's not what sets it apart from other candles. Twisted Lights look exactly like small balls of yarn. They look so much like a ball of yarn, it almost looks like somebody took a ball of yarn and dipped it in wax. And just like balls of yarn, Twisted Lights comes in lots of amazing colors, and they are 100% beeswax. Barmaids does not use any additives or hardeners in their candles, nor do they coat their molds with toxic mold release. You can get your Twisted Light candles at www.bar-maids.com.